art, music, literature. The purpose, it opens up the world, I believe, for people, makes them look at things a little bit differently. One of the things I wanted to have art and music here was a little bit unexpected. I want to always good to jar people a little bit, because then they sort of get a little off balance and start looking at things a little differently. But Seattle, when we think about culture here, we tend to think of major institutions and obviously grunge bands and things of that sort. But we are a great city for culture with regards to marches and parades. And there's just three I just want to mention. Yesterday, MLK Day, right? Thousands of people turned up, but what a lot of people don't know is that MLK Day, and they've been doing this for many years now in Seattle, they have workshops. And I attended one of the workshops with actually one of the teachers from the center school, John Goodman, who lost his job for a while, got it back because he was talking about institutional racism, and people felt uncomfortable about that, so they wanted to boot him out, but he came back, thank God. And one of the things there is there was a workshop on need for social justice teaching. And really, one of the things I talk to people about is the importance of democracy, the importance of participating in it, but also, and this is the thing that we don't emphasize enough, you can't really have a vibrant, accountable democracy unless you have social justice as well. The two go together. We have to continually think about it in that light. And then the other major cultural events, Gay Pride Day, parade, I should say, over 300,000 people participating in it now yearly. But when Mayor Wes Allman first started it, well, he didn't start it, he approved it, he put aside the last week of June to be Gay Pride Week. There were protests outside City Hall, and there was almost a movement to recall him. So we've come a long way. And then the other one is Hempfest. Can't forget Hempfest. Hempfest began in 1991 with 500 people in my old neighborhood in Volunteer Park, okay? I think Ashley was there. And now, for 3 days, 450,000 people. I think it's actually the largest in the world for a gathering on this. But what's interesting is, I've been there a number of times speaking, they have actually more speakers than they have bands playing. And it's really true. And the speakers talk about drug reform and the kinds of things they point out, things we sort of know, but you know, just tossing out one quick number. As late as year 2010, 52% of all the drug arrests in America were due to marijuana. So it's more than just ha 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 marijuana. It was not as a gateway drug to hard drugs, the gateway drug for arresting a lot of youth, and in particular, unfortunately, many, many black youth. In fact, they were arrested at twice the rate of white youth, and you can go on statistics about how that has impacted this whole country in a very negative way. So, but one of the things is that these three major events were all the result of community activists seeking to obviously change our society. And that change doesn't happen overnight. That's one of the things I talk about. In fact, it took 4 decades in Seattle organizing to get legalization of same-sex marriage and the legalization of recreational marijuana passed in 2012 by a popular vote initiative in both cases by 8 to 12% margins. And they went through a lot of struggles. It wasn't easy. As I like to say, is that victory is, it's often a marathon of incremental changes. But in the end, you have to have the endurance to continue. So this way you do get that victory. And you know, unfortunately, we're not as close in the area of racial equality. It's still a major ongoing struggle. One of the local activists, Jesse Hagopian, the teacher at Franklin High, just recently in the Weekly was interviewed. He made a very interesting point. He said, you know, we have to go, in so many words, he said, you have to go beyond racial equality. We need to start thinking of it in the terms of restorative justice and the practices of working together with people, with those people who feel they've been hurt and those people being accused. And together you begin to basically see the world differently and work together. And I'm going to go through, you know, seven-step program. I got sort of like 7 sort of steps in becoming, but for at least me and others perhaps, of becoming more of an active citizen. And the first one is consciousness. You know, and by the way, let me say, I define a citizen activist not as someone who's going to devote their life to it, not someone who's like a superhero or something of that sort. Basically, it's recognizing that you have the right and that you have the potential to improve your living conditions. And that's a very important first step, because a lot of people don't even get to that first step, recognizing that they can improve their working conditions, and they should, and they have a right to. It's funny, the old Marxist school would call it class consciousness, you know, and you used to write, Carl used to say, you know, you work in a factory and all of a sudden you look around and realize you're not, you know, you're not getting very far in your life, and so you need to organize with fellow workers. Nowadays, modern psychology, I think it's called mindfulness, something I'm accused of not having enough of by some, by close housemates, but but bottom line basically is being aware that decisions are being made around you that impact your life and the life of others, and that if you are not going to engage in influencing those decisions, then your future is going to be created by someone other than you. And I like to give the example, which I begin the book with two people who I suspect most people don't know here, but they were the people who got the ball rolling for the $15 minimum wage. And they were both fast food workers. One was Martina Phelps, and the other was Jason Harvey. Martina was 21 years old. She had been working at McDonald's for over a year, and she began to notice that her paychecks didn't match the number of hours she was put in. She was a classic case of wage theft, right? And she would go and complain to the manager, and the manager just brush her off, continue to do so. And in that situation, she realized that she was living in an intolerable situation. I mean, just, I don't read much in the book, but I pick out quotes. And this is a quote from her. After a while, it got so bad, she realized she had to take it upon herself. It's a quote, "I just didn't care what they thought of me. They were not part of my family. No one cared, and I had to do what was necessary to do." I mean, this is really heartfelt. This is someone who obviously is very involved with the family, very thinking of people as being kind, thinking of people caring, and realizing in this work situation, people didn't care about her. She had to sort of break out of the mold that she had been raised to actually do something, something that was very frightening. And Jason, who was in early 40s, had worked 8 years at Burger King, had never received a raise, and when he pointed that out to his boss, the boss said, "Oh, you do get a raise every year because you're on minimum wage and there's an escalator clause for inflation." So he was approached by someone from Working Washington, a coalition of neighborhood groups, church groups backed by unions, SEIU in particular, and they told him about a law that the corporations were pushing to go through Olympia to basically squeeze the workers even more. They were going to exclude trainees from the minimum wage and therefore reduce his hours, and he was barely hanging on. So he was very frightened about talking to anyone in a work situation, so he agreed to meet this person off away from work, and he agreed to sign a petition, very frightened about that. And then both he and Martina learned about this one-day workout, this one-day walkout in May of 2012. And he talked about what it took for someone who worked 8 years in a low-paying job to make up his mind to potentially risk that job. But you know what's interesting, he pointed out, what really motivated him besides being a bad work situation, and this is what's important about having victories. He said he realized that the paid sick leave legislation had passed in Seattle. And for the first time, he was getting paid sick leave. He had never had it before. And he realized it only was accomplished because people were willing to stand up, organize, and fight for it. And that gave him the credit, I mean, the courage to do something. So his quote was, "Part of me was scared out of my wits to do something like this, as necessary as it was to do." And then he looked at me and he was really proud. He goes, "You know, but courage is not the absence of fear. It's telling fear what its place is." It's like, whoa. And he walked out. You know, it's interesting. He was the only person to walk out from his place because most of his fellow workers only spoke Spanish, and he didn't speak Spanish. He was the only person to walk out. But when he came back, the rest of them were so proud of him, they were so emboldened, they started to make complaints, and management retaliated by laying off a couple of them. They took one troublemaker, and they made him a manager, 20 cents more an hour, and because of that, he couldn't go on strike because it was management. So, you know, the point being that you're aware of your situation, you get organized with others, and you can get something accomplished. The second step is know what you want the politicians to do. It doesn't do any good to just go in and complain, because they're going to say, yeah, that's a really bad situation. Sorry about it. And I've heard that a lot. I'm going to give you two quick examples. One is you may want to stop something bad from happening. An example I'm going to use is building a new waste transfer station in Georgetown. It happened a number of years ago. Or you may want to replace the status quo with something new. And I'm giving an example of the self-managed homeless encampments that replaced individuals who are sleeping under bridges and in doorways with a place to go 24/7 with the protection of having other people and being self-managed. In the transfer station, it's interesting. The citizens led the way there, and actually there are two residents. One was Kathy Nyland, and the other one's Holly, and this is, my staff will laugh at me because I've known her for years, and I always mispronounce her name, which I tend to do with a lot of people. But it's Kreschi, or close. But they were residents, and they raised the question of, why do we need a new transfer station? And the response was, well, we have so much trash, we gotta get rid of it. And obviously, we're gonna have to bring trains in, there'll be trucks in, and we have to find a new dump ground in Oregon. And then it was sort of funny, it was like the simple answer was like, well, why don't we just reduce the waste? Like, duh. And then Heather Trim came along, who was a researcher with a nonprofit. She volunteered her time, and then she started a group called Zero Waste Seattle. They hooked up council member Richard Conlon, who always wanted to push for zero waste, but felt that the bureaucracy wasn't there. He didn't have enough support on the city council. I was supportive. And felt that the community wasn't there. This really mobilized everyone. And as a result, the council did pass a styrofoam ban, container ban, and then a fee on plastic bags. It took about a year, a little over a year. We did it. There's only one vote against it. And this is the next thing. There will be opposition, and you will have to struggle for it. Basically, the plastic industry came to town, spent over $1.5 million, paid for signature gatherers, and they won the initiative. They got a referendum, basically. We said we passed the law, now let's have the people vote on it. They hammered home all these lies, distorted everything, and they won. So that was not the end of the story, right? Because, you know, in the end, the only way you get the victory is by getting to the victory, which means you have to continue the struggle. And there was elections going on. Other candidates came forward who were willing to support Richard and push the issue even further. Mike O'Brien came on. He worked the community along with Richard and much of us. We came back and we said, okay, we won't charge you a fee on the plastic bags. We'll just ban them. And you know, it was actually a stronger legal position to take. And we passed it, and we wore them down, and it went into effect, and other cities started doing it as well. Seattle was a real leader. And the styrofoam ban voucher was one of the biggest and one of the strongest in the nation as well. And encampments, I won't go as great a detail, but it goes all the way back. I don't know how many people remember the Goodwill Games. I was involved with them, other people. It was a very positive thing going on in Seattle. But there was a negative impact, and one of the negative impacts is a lot of people would be displaced. And Scott Morrow, who created Share, this happened about 90, 91, they found a place to put people. They worked with the mayor at the time, Norm Rice, who was supportive. They found where the Gates Foundation is now. There was an old bus barn. They moved in with the city's blessing. And they were able to create a self-managed encampment. In this case, it was actually in a building. And eventually they had to move, and they were asked to move by the chamber. Interesting enough, the residents there did not ask them to move, but when the mayor did, they did. They did not want to create you know, basically a big struggle. And they have continued to work on self-managed encampments until Mayor McGinn supported it. The council sort of dragged their feet, never really came through. And Ed Murray was elected. He did follow through on his promise. And now we have three locations, and we're going through to put those locations into effect. And, you know, one of the things that got me, one of the strongest arguments against the encampments was, this is from fellow council members, no names mentioned, is, well, we can't have people live in the tents. That's not right. And it's like, they're not living under anything right now. What are you talking about? You know, at least they have a place to go and have protection and have a place to keep their goods. But now they're actually turning into not tent encampments, using what they call mini houses and working with moving up the standards, which is quite impressive. So anyhow, third step, be specific in your ask. And what I mean is, and this gets very sort of wonkish, but very critical, you go to a council member, and any legislator, you can use the state as well, and you ask, you know, you have a problem, right? And you're not complaining. And you want a specific thing that you want. That's important. And if they say, I'm supportive, that basically is zero, okay? Because I tell you, anyone is supportive. If they're not supportive, they're, you know, they got a dead heart. So, you know, so you really want to put them on the spot. You want to basically go, will you sponsor this legislation? I want your, not just your name saying you'll vote for it, we want your name up front. We want you to say you'll sponsor it. 9 times out of 10, or 9 out of 9, whatever, you may not get that. Then ask them to be a co-sponsor. But if you get a sponsor, it's more likely to get co-sponsors, okay? Co-sponsor means their name is still up there. And, you know, council members, legislators feel more protection if they know there's other people around them, other legislators, other electeds. If they won't do either of those two things, then ask if they'll vote for the legislation and try to get some sort of firm response on that. Although I have found at times when someone has told me they're going to vote for legislation, on the dais, I got a surprise. And it wasn't a pleasant one. But once you get someone who's doing one of the first three or supportive of something strong, ask to keep in the loop. Now, legislation changes all the time. There's always going to be drafts. There's always going to be changes. But try to make sure that you're in the loop as much as possible. And that's really helps the legislature as well, or the council member, craft something. In fact, one of the successes I had in the paid sick leave was I just worked very closely with the advocates, day in and day out, every change we measured as we're going forward. Try not to run too far ahead of your supporters, because I've seen that happen, and you end up making people upset and not really moving the ball forward. You have to be a team player. Fourth step, make allies, okay? You can't do it alone. You need allies. In paid sick leave, look for the broadest set of allies. We really worked closely with Main Street Coalition, which was with small businesses. Use those businesses that supported paid sick leave to write editorials, make sure that they were, in many ways, also part of the public face. We used health officials to point out that, you know, if you're going to a restaurant, someone's coughing in your food, it's probably because they're sick and they don't have paid sick leave. That actually turned a lot of people off the sick food and saying, yeah, I want paid sick leave, you know, to the places I go. And we had restaurant owners supporting it as well, for the reason. It changes the narrative, okay? The second sort of example is minimum wage. There, working Washington, as I mentioned, Economic Opportunity Institute provided excellent data. You know, you need allies because they often will be able to provide research, and you need a constant give and take to go back and change the narrative. And paid sick leave is that, well, you know, all the small businesses will fold. We found a research done in San Francisco, had done it years before, that in fact, restaurants who they were afraid would go out of business did better in San Francisco with paid sick leave than those that did not. So you need to get the truth out, which often will support progressive changes we're talking about. And also, with allies, particularly institutional allies, ask if they'll devote staff. Staff is critical. You can do a lot with volunteers, and volunteers are very good in a short campaign period, but also with staff, that means that you can go back and get something done right away, rather than, you know, unfortunately, volunteers have other lives. Media. Media is not necessarily an ally, but they are a megaphone, right? So you want to be able to use that megaphone for your purposes. For one thing, think of reporters as basically someone else who's got a job, who's got to do something. Meet them, if they're willing to, outside their beat. Go for a coffee. Find out what makes them tick, what they're interested in. Particularly columnists. Columnists are, as you probably know, they're the stars of the media world because they can basically write whatever they want. There's very few of them. If you can convince one of them that this is an important, controversial topic, they can take off and write about it. So work the media. And then also, getting more sophisticated, there's assignment editors, particularly for TV and radio. Find out who they are. In other words, do a little research on media. Learn how to work with it and how to direct them. Corporations do it all the time. Fifth step is, as I said, using data, make sure you get it. But also, review the data that the other side is using. In the area of, for instance, there was legislation being promoted by one of the council members to basically ban panhandling downtown. Actually, we banned it so much as the large fines for aggressive panhandling, which is already a law in the books, but it was basically brought across as this will stop panhandling because a lot of people are concerned. And they came out with an opinion poll showing that, see, people are really frightened about panhandling. Well, we got a hold of the polls, did some analysis, and that was not shown to be true. And then we did our data crunching because the whole thing was panhandling breeds crime. And then we looked at where the people who are receiving food stamps, human services, receiving basically overnight shelter, tend to be panhandling in those areas. Compared that to the 911 calls and crime data, they were some of the lowest in the city. That was a very powerful data. We released that data. We were basically going toe to toe. So when you look at your opponents, what are their arguments? Get the data that they're looking at. And I'll tell you, it's like people drowning in an average, 3-foot river. There's always another side to data. You go deep enough, you can always find some contradictions and something that doesn't fit. And that's what you're going for. And then, don't be afraid to ask for a public disclosure request. We did that in that instance, and it turns out we came across an email from the police chief to the prime sponsor of this legislation that said, panhandling is not a problem for the police. It's not a crime. That pretty much turned the tide. A sixth step is know the tools that are available to you for getting your word out and for organizing. Now, I go through the whole chapter, all kinds of tools, but let's start with protests. Protests are important, they're critical. There's a lot of controversy about, Black Lives Matter disrupting a Bernie Sanders speech here. And, that's not my personal style, but some people came and said, well, is that right or wrong? I said, look, that's not the issue, right or wrong. These people are angry, these people are upset. It's gonna happen. But what you need to figure out is where do you go afterwards? And where do you do as well as that? It doesn't have to be disruptive in any sort of disruptive in any sort of bothering other people. In fact, I use the example, I don't know how many people remember Tommy Smith and John Carlos, 1968, at the Olympics. We're talking about, the Olympic Games. They had just won the 200-meter race. Tommy Smith had set a world record. And they got to the platform. They bowed their heads where the anthem was being played. And they raised their black leathered fists in a power salute. And later they described it as a human rights salute. Captured not just the U.S., international attention. It was so totally broken the mold a protocol. They were immediately called back to the United States. They were stripped of their medals. They received death threats. And Sports Illustrated, on the cover, wrote, "Black athlete, a shame." But you know, they created a positive history. It came across a quote here from the person who is the, member of the Canadian Olympic Committee. So in 2011, Akash Maharaj said that Smith and Carlos became the living embodiments of Olympic idealism. Ever since, they have been inspirational to generations of athletes like myself, who can only aspire to their example of putting principle before personal interest. And that's what it comes down to. It's a very scary but very thing to do. The other thing too in our town, other sort of silent protests, I don't know how many people are familiar with Women in Black, standing silently outside City Hall and other areas for the number of people who've died outside in the shivering cold due to being homeless. You know, at first I didn't know what they were there for. I'm sure a lot of other people didn't, and then started asking. A reminder that we are a society. Initiatives. I want to talk about initiatives just briefly. It's a very important tool. Sometimes it is used by the enemy. I mean, when I say the enemy, I mean people who want more power or take power away from folks. We know who those folks are. And they use paid signature gatherers, and that's another whole thing I'm not going to talk about. But one of the other reasons I have both Johnny and Tim from the Pipe Hoist Market, because the Pipe Hoist Market, everyone is taking on sort of a mythical value. We saved the Pipe Hoist Market. Like, everyone belongs to we now, right? It was interesting. When the Pipe Hoist Market was saved, it wasn't perceived that way initially. There was a huge federal grant available to the city. I've heard this before, and I'm hearing it now, often for other projects. This is free money. All you have to do is X. With this free money, what they were going to do with the Pike Place Market is tear down 90% of the buildings and replace it with spanking new hotels, offices, and restaurants. Sounds good to me. These buildings are falling apart, right? And 8 of the 9 council members were in favor of it, as well as the mayor, as well as both newspapers, and even some of the small businesses said, hey, you know, I can take advantage of this. And we all know Victor Steinbrück, a professor, sometimes grumpy, but stubborn, which is what you need to be, and other people joined him, Emmett Watson and things of that sort, journalists. Within 3 weeks, they gathered 25,000 signatures. They put it on the ballot. It passed by close to 75% of the vote, one of the highest ever. The leaders of this city were out to lunch. One last thing, public forums. Think of holding a public forum if you need momentum. If you invite the electeds there. Senator Pramila Jayapal was another citizen. 9/11 occurred. Muslim community in particular was being harassed. Muslim teachers were being harassed in school. Police started doing raids. They did one on Mini Mark in the Rainier Valley. And in that instance, what happened was that, took out food and everything. They were thinking it was used as a subversive center. She pulled together a public forum. I think it was actually held here, upstairs. 1,000 people showed up. It was packed. And they had testimony, the council listened, and from that came Hate-Free Zone, and then One America, which replaced that. I worked with them passing legislation, some of the first in the nation, passing a code that said our police officers, in fact, no one, no city employee would cooperate with the INS to check on whether someone was did not have their proper papers. Quickly, I'll get through this. Media tools, I want to just say that, books are great for in-depth, long-term organizing. But don't forget posters. Remember 15 Now poster? In the day of social media, the 15 Now poster was probably one of the most powerful images out there to organize people around. Tweeting's still very good. Tweeting's excellent for getting people out immediately for demonstrations and movements and getting the word out. Can't write much with 140 characters, so it has its limits. Blogs are good for disseminating information, but you have to drive people to the blog. If you don't, they're dead. So they have to be hooked up with something. I actually like email lists. It goes a little old-fashioned, but you can target, you can track. And now that you've got, obviously, Constant Contact, MailChimp, you can use them as very powerful tools. I started my urban politics a year and a half before I got on the city council, even before I thought I was going to be running, and I'm going to continue doing it. I think it's a good way of keeping people informed. The last weapon, or tool, I should say, not weapon. It can be used as a weapon. I've been told, keep away from military. Examples. Elections. Vote. It's important to vote because voting determines who controls government. That determines whether you build schools or you build for-profit sports stadiums. That decides whether police are accountable or not, whether people can find affordable housing or decent paying jobs. It's not the marketplace that's looking out for the community. That's not the purpose of the marketplace. The purpose of the marketplace is to sell stuff and make a profit. The purpose of a democratic government is to protect its people. And that's what voting's all about, is making sure that we control the government. And I want to use a quote. I actually end the book in this because it was an interesting juxtaposition of two quotes. And I won't get into it now, maybe in the question and answer. I visited perhaps one of the most successful right-wing organizations in the United States called ALEC. They, you know, have done an amazing job of controlling state governments. But anyhow, I said, you know, despite the political differences between conservatives and liberals or right-wing and left-wing activists, the glue, and there is some glue, that holds all of us within the sphere of a democracy is the belief that we make our laws through elected representation, assuming that it's not bought election, that's why you need honest elections, or that citizens can vote, do not have voter suppression, and assuming also that they have good information. But given those, a Seattle police officer who attacked Seattle city government for violating his liberty by requiring him to attend social justice training, because it violated his liberty, he wrote to his fellow police officers, watch out, elections have consequences. I thought it was a great endorsement. Eric Davis, a cousin of Michael Brown, who many of you know, unarmed youth killed by a police officer in Ferguson, Missouri, said, show up at the voting booths. Let your voices be heard. Both of them understood where the power for changing the world lies. It lies in us and making sure we get out. And the last step, and I'll end with this, is it's attitude. That's important. The first sort of basic attitude is listen, because you learn more by listening than by talking. Knowledge is power. That's what you're searching for. Know what your opponent wants. Know what he or she is promising to deliver. Listen for inconsistencies in their message. And listen to what people want and what they need. They may not be the same often. And you may realize there's openings there to shed light on a new solution, and one that will actually benefit them rather than have the mirage of benefiting them. And lastly, believe. Believe that the power to create the future belongs with the citizens. You have to recognize that the strongest tool is a functional, accountable democracy. And that is what we must always strive for, because the libertarians, the Koch brothers, the far right, their goal is very simple. It's essentially to shrink government to the point of zero, because they will have the playing field to themselves. They continue, but Ronald Reagan popularized it by mocking government and making it a joke and mocking public servants, making them as lazy, and basically saying you can't trust government. They want to feed the image of government as being incompetent, as if corporations don't go bankrupt. They want to feed the image of government as not helping you, as if corporations did. They want to essentially, I always describe them as anarchists, they want to destroy government, because what that leaves then is them. So never give up the belief that when cynicism replaces hope, weakness displaces strength. And those who benefit from a dysfunctional democracy reap the rewards at the expense of the rest of us. And lastly, enjoy life and pursue happiness. Because if you're afraid to be positive and you're always grumping, you're always complaining, how can you expect others to be positive about going forward, right? You have to realize that if you realize that it's right to create your own future, then you become a citizen activist. Thank you.
I have a question.
There you go.
Hi, Nick. So, Nick, I bought the book.
Yay!
I've been looking at it. I've read a chapter or two already. So I want to know the list you just gave us that was so succinct. How come it's not in the book?
I had limited time. that's the sequel. that's a fair question, and I toyed with that throughout, but I would say that the book is more subtle. I mean, all those points are there. In fact, there's even more points, and there's more examples. I enjoyed writing it because there's a lot of small examples showing of things you can do. But, you know, I wasn't going to sit here, read the book, or bury you in stories and examples. So I forced myself to sit down and think about, okay, I've got to sort of pull this together. So that's what I did. Maybe I should.
I want the list.
Okay. Fair enough. Oh, both sides. Okay.
Hi, Nick. This is Margaret.
Margaret, yes, hi.
I couldn't resist. You know, there's the government, there's marketplace, there's nonprofits. Can't we also be activists as consumers, where we buy, what we buy, where we invest our money? Can't we be activists with co-ops and social responsible investment? I mean, government, I'm totally with you, but we can be activists in other areas too.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I was with WASHPIRG, Washington Public Interest Research Group, and that's all about basically protecting consumer interests. This is a market economy. We're not going to change it, okay? And we have the ability to influence that market positively. In fact, some of the people here, I don't know if you're social investing, you know, is critical. Where you put your dollars and who you support. Obviously, there's multiple issues, everything from organic food and GMO, getting out of food and things of that sort. So absolutely. I touch on it a little bit in the book, but that's legitimate and important. Yes?
Nick, how can we stop the urban or the development people from giving these huge sums of money to corporations and others to win them over by municipality subsidizing, as we have in Seattle with these tall skyscrapers now and everything, we can't even get a decent transportation system. How can we get that money flowing back to small businesses that really deserve it and incubators and collaborative systems working with people? How can activists get involved in stopping the money games?
Well, that struggle has been going on for a while. I was at it for 18 years. It's interesting. I was being interviewed and they asked me, how do people in the community see the council? You know, is it a spectrum, right, left? And I said, my experience going out to community groups in particular, neighborhood groups, they don't think of it that way. It's basically pro-developer and not pro-developer because they recognize how often the impact is to their neighborhood and how unbalanced it is often. I'll tell you, that's going to be an ongoing struggle. It's not going to end at any one particular time, okay? I think there is going to be a major struggle and debate coming up this coming year. People may be familiar with HALA, it's one of the task force the mayor put together. You know, I supported it, but I'll tell you the truth, it could have gone a lot farther, could have been a lot stronger, and I think that the bargain was not the best bargain we could have made. But in any case, I don't want to get too wonkish here, but I'll give you an example. Most cities our size require developers to put in between 10, 12, sometimes as high as 15% low-income housing in new development. In Seattle, we barely have gotten to 5%, okay? And the HALA agreement's supposed to push it up higher. That, in my mind, is one of the major, because if you do that throughout the city, you, in fact, assure, and this is how it works, that you have people in your neighborhood supporting local businesses. If you're just going to be looking at high-end housing, you know, you're looking about people who basically are not interested in the local store. They want to go to high fashion stores and high expensive places, or they buy stuff offline. So that's one important struggle. The other is in the area of transportation. Now, thankfully, the bus system, we passed a tax on that. But one of my pet concerns is that we do not pay enough attention to how we get people to work using public transportation. We spend too much time thinking about the next fancy project, particularly fixed rail, which I've always been, I would say, a skeptic about its cost effectiveness. And if you look at the project that's coming on the line now is the First Avenue streetcar. When we basically passed the legislation for transportation, buses, I wanted to make sure that we were not going to necessarily siphon off large amounts of that or any money to the First Avenue streetcar. I could not wring out, and I literally had to, the director of the transportation, a commitment that that would not happen, which concerns me. And this is the class, this is why I brought up the Pike Place Market. There is perhaps as large as a $70 million grant from the federal government to build the streetcar. What people don't talk about is probably going to cost close to $200 million. It's like, where does that other money come from, you know? And, you know, streetcars have a function, a positive function. They generally help the retail businesses along the line for that mile line. And I never argue against that. They don't, if they're not incorporated and they don't provide reliable, fast service, they don't help the whole system. And you have to think of a system of transportation. So that's my major concern about that project. And I would encourage people to watch it closely and put pressure on the council members to ask the right questions and not go blindly down a very deep hole that they may not get out of easily. Sorry, I couldn't be more specific, but those are two items to keep your eyes on. Yes.
This is a habit I just don't want to let go of quite yet. You know, in addressing you, I still want to say, Councilmember Licata, what are your thoughts? What are your thoughts on the subject you've raised of voting today? Voting participation has just drops off every year. Every year, it gets worse and worse. And it relates, I think, to how people perceive that government and electeds, with all the things they juggle, their own career as an elected, the other politicians, they see politics as something that really does not lead to solutions. And this is talking to people that are very involved in their community, they're volunteers, they care about issues, but they've lost faith in politics. What in your experience can help turn that around? And could you solve the Seattle traffic problem?
Walk to work. Well, first of all, you know, actually, even though our latest turnout was lower than typical in Seattle, you don't want to grade on a curve, but if you did, Seattle actually is doing amazingly better. You know, New York, even when de Blasio won, I think their turnout was less than 30%, like 25%. Los Angeles was down in the 20s as well. Unfortunately, it's common in a lot of cities. And one of the problems is there is truly, there's some structural things you can do to increase voting, for one thing. People have done, how you register is important. You can do same-day registration. You can basically do, in Europe, they have election day holidays to turn out. So there's a lot of structural changes you can do, and that's one of the things I'm interested in working with, and there's some national groups trying to do that type of thing. But so there's structural things. You mentioned mostly attitude, people, you know, losing confidence. Wherever there is a contested race, generally it's higher, so you do want contested races, and that's one of the reasons why public financing campaigns is important, because you allow candidates to run that may not run and offer different ideas. The other two is, the other issue, the other way to get out is candidates who are sensible but are willing to take strong positions on issues. That will also drive voter turnout. So you have to reward candidates to basically go on a limb. You know, you turn out and support them. I'll use, you know, quite honestly, Lisa Herbel is a great example. Tremendous turnout for her in West Seattle. I mean, overall, you could say, well, they're higher votes in the past, but, you know, they outspent her 3-1, and she won. And the reason... And the reason there was so much money spent against her is because they knew she was going to do something. And so basically what it comes down to is that you want to vote for people in the office who are not necessarily nice people, okay? That's, I mean, it'd be nice if they were, but what's more important is that, are they going to deliver? Are they actually going to be out there willing to fight? And I think that to a certain extent, there's an obligation on activists to actually, as you throw your support to someone, just don't endorse and walk away. Work with that person, and don't abandon that person once they're in office. That's the next big problem. I've seen a lot of people elected to office, well-intentioned, and really positive values, and they feel lost. Partly is because they don't have a strong support system behind it. That part's their fault, but the activists also have to enforce that sort of accountability. Okay, I'm losing Nora.
Hi, Nick. Right now, of course, everyone, the Tim Iman efforts are extremely well known. And apparently the courts are going to make their decision Thursday morning. And then all the legislation is going to get voted on in the Senate Thursday at 10 a.m. So the question is, and that's the legislation that is sort of changed the Constitution so that a very small minority can decide about any tax increases. That's one part of it. And the other part is a loss of sales tax for, you know, $1.2 billion. So both of those are gonna, so all that's happening on Thursday. So what, and most people don't know that it's all happening on Thursday, I think. So what do we do?
Okay. well, I mean, there is social media out there. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if you use if you tweet or not. But you might want to start. No, but I mean, seriously, you know, I use this as an example. The use of social media is really, really powerful in getting the word out quickly. And this is the perfect example. Councilmember Shama Sawant is without doubt, and I have the numbers here. I forget, a powerhouse in getting the word out. And she works with people. I mean, she has her own party, which is good, but you can work, you can create your own networks and multiply it. I mean, I did some statistical analysis on here. It's really retweeting. Sorry, I'll never get that. Really multiplies who you get out to. So you have to do that. But the message should be really simple. If they're going to vote coming out, unfortunately, Republicans, you know, are in there, but you have to make sure that you get whoever is there to vote against it. Use, you know, make sure you have a good argument. You might use a different argument for Democrats or Republicans. But also, I'm not sure, is this subject to a veto from the governor or not? If it's a legislation, it should be. So you, that may come down to having to also put pressure on the governor to do something. So But anyhow, I guess the short answer is you got to organize, you got to put a lot of time and energy into it, and you got to, you know, think about the tools you're going to use to get the word out.
Well, I hope somebody knows how to tweet out there.
Yes.
Hey, thanks for coming. You began with a very heartwarming appeal to culture, you know, calling out the artists you invited and everything. But then you sort of transitioned into a series of descriptions of the marijuana, gay marriage, $15, all this sort of legislation, and then you walked us through the whole sausage making of legislation.
Yeah.
And so, due respect to the sausage fans out there, what would you say to those people, including, for example, the Black Lives Matter activists, who say, what we don't need is a series of further laws. What we need is transformations of mindsets, transformations at the cultural level. So, do you agree with those people? And if you do so, what would you say is the role of citizen activists in enacting that social justice change at a cultural level as opposed to strictly a legislative piecemeal way?
Well, I'm very conscious starting with the cultural because I think it's important to think that culture shapes how we view the world, and I think that's what you're saying. And so how do we change people's view of the world? And that the sausage making is maybe seen as sort of not directly addressing the issue of, well, you're not changing people's views of the world, just changing laws. But they go hand in hand, and that's the point I'm trying to make, is that you've got to do both. You just doing one without the other, it doesn't work. You can't enforce laws that people are not going to believe in. And if you can't often change way people see the world if they are limited in the information they get, and if they are not, and so that's why changing the laws is important, so they get better information and that they also have an ability to function. The point of trying to change the way we look at the world, change the culture we're in, is an immense task. It's something that does not happen, rarely happens overnight. The whole issue of Black Lives Matter is unfortunately been around a long time in different ways. The formation, of the Black Panther Party, ironically began around a poet. Bobby Seale and Huey Newton were reciting a poem in Berkeley 50 years ago, next month. And they were arrested for obscenity. They objected, so they were arrested for obstruction. They resisted, they were arrested for restriction, handcuffed and beaten. 2 months later, they formed the Black Panther Party for self-defense. They are very much a belief of changing the way we look at the world. But they also believed in political organizing and trying to change the laws. So I don't have a short answer I think you have a legitimate issue. I think it's an issue that we all struggle with. I think part of it is like that workshop I went to in the MLK workshop is teaching social justice. One of the things that I think we need to do is look at the educational system. One of the things, I tie it back to democracy a lot because the point I'm trying to get at is I'm trying to redefine or highlight citizenship, being a citizen, is that we all have value and that we all have some control over our future and we all have some control over government. That's the value I'm trying to work with because I think that value will get us to the point of recognizing that citizenship in a democracy is based on social justice. And I think that's a door opener for a lot of people who, if I go and talk to just about social justice right away, and I grew up in a very conservative household, their minds aren't open. So I'm trying to open their minds. You know, just a sidebar. I had dyslexia. I could not read until the fourth grade, okay? And that some of the first stuff I read was John Birch material. I don't know how many people know how. And the reason I did is my dad was a barber, okay? And all the John Birchers would get their hair cut there for some reason. I don't know why. And they'd leave the pamphlets. My dad, who never went beyond eighth grade, but read a lot, would read them and bring them home. So, and I, you know, and I understand how those people view the world, and they're still out there. They're called John Birchers, but there's a lot out there. I want to crack that group. I want to open up their minds. I want them to understand that there needs to be a cultural change. So, yes.
Yes, hi, this has been great, great speech. I'm practicing to give speeches, so I really appreciated your structure.
Oh.
And so I just wanted to ask you a really pragmatical question. Would you be willing and able to take the 7 points and put them on your website?
Yes.
Awesome, thank you.
I have to copyright them. No, I will. Yes.
I have a question about the homelessness issue in Seattle. I think that most of us realize that mental health service is one of the driving forces behind and increasing homelessness and just the combination of economic issues and mental health issues. And my question is, can you give a clue to someone? I really appreciated in your talk about people doing activism on behalf of something that's their own issue. But I do think there are also a lot of people who are middle class, people who might have an ability to help but don't know what's going to be an effective. And that's how I feel personally in this area about homelessness. So to attack that problem more, attack, to use your war word, to deal with that problem more holistically or in a whole way, can you suggest, is there someone in Seattle that, or a group that could work with both the current efforts to find space for people to live in that's more like the Inner Bay encampment that just opened, but in the mental health area, like people who can step forward within the city that others could work with, not who are homeless, but to do a solution that then could coalesce to some mental health amelioration of, you know, more services in the mental health area within the city. Do you have any advice on that for people? Because until that part is solved, is also dealt with in some level, it seems there won't be justice or life, a quality of life for the people who are that powerless.
You know, the points you make about mental health are totally legitimate. The numbers that have come out, the number of people who are homeless, who are suffer from mental illness is huge. Sometimes it's due because they are homeless, and that has to be recognized. But sometimes they've had, I've met so many people who are homeless who've had very middle-class lives. Something goes wrong, they don't have that big of a margin in their finances. They begin to self-medicate, often it's alcohol, and then that leads to total breakdown. It's just disgusting what's happened in this state and unfortunately other states that have withdrawn support for mental health. There are people on our street that should be in hospitals. In fact, I know they've said in Los Angeles and Chicago, and maybe I'm not sure about this area, their county jails are in fact their mental health institutions. That's what's happened. You know, when I went to this ELLE conference, I was shocked though by the number of people who see themselves as, you know, conservative to further right, on their own volition, without any prompting from me, saying, you know, two things they said. One, we have a major heroin problem out there. They were scared. It wasn't like they were just trying to, you know, they didn't know where I was coming from. Sometimes, you know, it's like, you know, they were. And the second thing was, it's a mental health problem. They kept saying that it's a mental health problem. A lot of these people. These are the people cutting government. And yet they know that the private sector is not dealing with it. So there, I think, and this is the sort of the opening I would hope that we can make, quite honestly, this goes back into the sausage making, the opening of state legislature to get the proper funding we need to reopen some of these facilities and to offer more money available. Because I think that the realization is coming down that we can't continue the way we are now. We are literally crumbling our society from the inside. You know, we don't need an invasion. We're doing it to ourselves. And I think that the problem is now so totally apparent that we do need to organize, but I think we have a better response from not just Democrats, and a lot of Democrats are responsible for those cuts as well, but from everyone pointing out that unless we do something, and this is self-interest, we are all going to basically suffer. But a lot of these people have family members or have extended family members who've seen what's going on. So, you know, I mean, we could sit down and work out a long strategy, and that's the kind of thing I'd, you know, love to do, but I think there's an opening there for actually reaching out and bringing people on board for these significant changes that are needed. Yes.
Hi.
Hello,
Elizabeth. Good to see you. I wanted to just make a couple of remarks and compliments to your book.
Oh, thank you.
I think it's a really important, you've got really important messages to get out, and I think it's more than just the list of things that you need to do, but it's the stories of successes that we've had in this city. One of the most effective ways to discourage people from trying to initiate change or support change is to convince them that it's hopeless.
Right.
And I think that the Republican Party has done a really excellent job of pushing this, it's hopeless, you know,
right.
Throw it all out, we got to do something really crazy. And I think that, you know, your set of stories really needs to get a wider distribution. It's the kind of thing that I think can encourage people to go out and say, hey, it is possible to make change. I wish I had was seeing a larger percentage of 20-year-olds in this audience, because I think that, unfortunately, many people in that age range do think it's pretty much hopeless and everything has to be sort of torn down and start all over again. And I think it also discourages voter participation in that area. So I would really encourage you and anybody else who's trying to make this kind of change, learn how to tweet and use every social media platform that you can if you want people in their 20s and early 30s and younger to hear the messages that you have. It's really, and
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for what you've done.
Yeah, thank you. I just want to add that I actually have started reaching out to at least three specific high school teachers to go to the classes, talk about this, and hopefully use this or something else to help folks organize, as well as working with college students and working with Washburg and some other students. So, I mean, that's the future. That's critical. But I thank all of you for being here, even if you're not 20-year-olds.
No, I'll be the last one. Pull it down, okay, or speak up, or both. Hi, I'm Constance Miller, and I know that the combination of citizen activism and legislative advocacy are very powerful and effective. This is very brief. back in 2007, I pulled together a bunch of people and I drafted a piece of legislation that was passed in one session of the legislature.
Wow.
Thank you. It created a legal definition for brain trauma in Washington State and an account to fund the programs and to educate state agencies on the realities of traumatic brain injury. The agencies did not want to operate outside of their comfort zone and they pushed back. But I hung in there and helped make it work, period. End of that. That's by way of introduction. Currently, I live in the Beacon Hill Light Rail neighborhood. They built it literally in my front yard. 5 years, I endured it. Subsequent to its completion, massive multi-family apartments, condos, that kind of stuff have sprung up around me. I own a single family house there, and my interest at this time, at my age and the economy, is to redevelop my single family home into a HALA type, green type, multi-story, multi-income type dwelling. Now, I've written about this in, let's see, I think it was a city council online meeting. I've written and asked questions about what resources were available for this idea of mine. I haven't gotten any emails back. And that was like months ago when there was those online meetings. What I'd like from you at this time, and maybe once you're seated at your book table, and I came prepared to buy a copy, is specific names of people in departments that I can go to for zoning information. I know there have been recent zoning changes that would accommodate my idea. And the Housing Trust, and any information you can give me or person you can point me to about developers, because I know I'd have to work with the developer. Sure. There's no way anybody would work with an individual old lady to do such a massive project.
Okay.
So
I'll work on it.
When you're at your table, I'll give you my money, you'll give me my book, and I have a list here so I won't forget my questions. Talk about stubborn. Getting that bill passed in one session of the legislature took some doing.
Thank you, Constance. That was a very phenomenal success. Thank you. And thank you all at the table.